I hope I'm audible. Am I audible? Okay. So greetings to you from mini Israel. I say mini Israel is, I'm from, this is Tiruvalla. And if you take the density of population of believers in Tiruvalla, that would probably be one of the highest in the world. If you go to the street and preach, probably one of the passers-by will correct you. Oh, that is not written there. But so many believers are here. So it's a great place to be, and thank you for inviting me. And it's great to see all of you. And so this has been such a tumultuous year. Everything has changed, and our vocabulary has also changed. If someone of was were asked, what is the coronavirus last year this time? Nobody would know. Nobody would know what is the coronavirus. But now, if you ask anybody in the planet what is the coronavirus, everybody knows. Right? So even our vocabulary has changed during this year. And I would like to share a PowerPoint with you, and I'll be using PowerPoints to make points. It's the way we go. I'll just share my screen. Pastor Wilson, could you please allow me to share screen? In that security tab, there'll be, you can click it and there'll be allowed to share screen. I don't know, it's okay. Yeah, thank you. Just a minute. Okay, so how would you describe this year, 2020, and what words would you use it? You might use it as sad, tragic, pointless, hopeless. These would be some words which we use to describe this year. But as children of God, how should we describe it? What is happening around us? So let me bring before you this very familiar verse, Romans 8:28. And it goes like this. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. So we use it day in, day out for this thing and that thing. But actually, this verse has 3 points. So it goes like this. So do all bad humans have a good purpose? Right? So there are 3 important qualifications. First is, in all things, good or bad, God can bring out good. We know the famous verse in Genesis 15:22, you intended to harm me, but God intended for good. The second thing, this is the key point. This promise is for those who love God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him. There is a snake in the earth. It is for those people that this is going to come out for good. And when we say good, what does that mean? Does not mean that we are going to get a lot of money and blessings and all. It might not mean. The word that is intended there is the spiritual, eternal work which God wants to bring out. Okay. So for those who love God, these things are going to happen. So how do we know, how do we know that we love God? It is said clearly, John 14:15, if you love me, you will keep my commands. And 1 John 5:3 says, in fact, this is love for God, to keep His commands. So when you come down, if you love God, everything happens for good. So how do we love God? By keeping His commands. And His commands are not burdensome. Now, let me just go back to the basics. So we are talking about loving God. Let me just go back to the basics. Can anyone guess what this is? You might say, the children might say, this is a galaxy or Milky Way and all. But no, actually, this is the roof of a Rolls-Royce car. So you can customize your Rolls-Royce car like this. You in Dubai might be seeing it left and right. In Kerala, we see it infrequently. So this is actually the roof of the Rolls-Royce. So they just, this Rolls-Royce car, which is the most luxurious car in the world, has a lot of things to it, a lot of accessories. It has handcrafted leather and a lot of things. It has an umbrella, the large boot space. And it's said that when you travel in a Rolls-Royce car, the only sound you can hear is the sound of the clock which is sitting on the mantelpiece. All said and done, how the Rolls-Royce car looks. all said and done, but it's good to have all this accessible. But what is the basic thing? It should have an engine and 4 wheels. Otherwise, it won't travel. So the basic thing a car needs to have is an engine and 4 wheels. Without that, even if you have the starlit roof or all the other luxuries, it is all a waste if you don't have the engine and 4 wheels. Otherwise, it won't be able to travel because it's a car. So that's a basic thing. So this is what actually what Jesus also want to bring out in Matthew 23:23. He was saying to the Pharisees, "Woe to you, Pharisees! You give tenth of your spices. You give tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you are neglecting the more important matters. And what are the more important matters? Justice, mercy, and faithfulness." Now, mint and dill are herbs, garden herbs, and cumin is a small seed. So what the Pharisees used to do is that they would count out all the cumins. Oh, okay, I got 100 cumins. Now I'm going to give 10 of this to God. So they were so particular about these rituals. But God was telling them, go back to the basics. All these things are important. What I want is justice, mercy, and faithfulness. And that is what Jesus is saying, love God and love your neighbor. So we have this another famous verse where Jesus is saying, you strain out a gnat, but you swallow a camel. So what does that mean? So in Leviticus chapter 11, God has laid out certain restrictions for how the Israelites should eat. So they should strain out, no crawling thing should be there in the food. So what the Pharisees used to do is whenever they used to drink something, when they drink wine, they would strain out with a fine cloth. So that is the smallest thing they could strain out. And the largest unclean thing they could eat was the camel. So this is using actually contrasting things. Strain out a gnat, but you eat a camel. So what it's keeping on saying is that you are missing the basic, you are missing the basic points. And we have a degree in Kerala called the BCom. It is called Bachelor of Commerce. So the marks go like this for a Bachelor of Commerce. There are 1,500 marks. So if suppose a student who is studying Bachelor of Commerce, he says, I like Hindi and English, and he keeps on studying it. How much mark is he going to get? Maximum is going to get 200 marks. But what is important for him? This is important for him to study commerce, because this is a commerce subject. So they are missing the, when we study Hindi and English, we are missing the main point. We are missing the forest for the trees. The person is supposed to study commerce. In the same way, as a Christian, what we are supposed to concentrate on justice, mercy, and faithfulness. So don't major in minor things. Don't major in minor things. Major in major things. And that, what is that? Love God and love others. Now, it is because of lack of time, actually, I'm going a bit fast. And I pray to God that some of this will remain in your mind. The key thing is that keep first things first. And the Lord bring to your mind if there's anything in your life that is keeping you from going closer to God. So from where did Jesus arrive at this? Matthew 23:23. Actually, Jesus is coming from Micah 6:8. Micah 6:8 is one of the beautiful verses of the Old Testament which brings out God's heart. So what is that famous word? It goes like this. What does the Lord require of you? But to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. So this is the key verse for today, Micah 6:8. Even if you forget everything what I say today, remember this key verse, Micah 6:8. What does the Lord require of you? But to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. So let's go in. Now, some of us may know that in the Jewish law, there are 613 laws. In the Old Testament, there are 613 laws. Now, what the Pharisees did is that for them to obey all the 613 laws, to ensure that they obey the 613 laws, they made a lot of fence laws. Fence laws are actually over 1 lakh in number. They made almost 1 lakh fence laws. An example of fence law is like, you know that in a Sabbath, a person is not supposed to work. So they made a fence law that in Sabbath, they should not even take up a pencil. So that this is to make ensure that they don't work at all. So a lot of fence laws were there. And so in that 613 laws, actually, it's interesting that there are 365 negative laws and 248 positive things to do. And this 240 is actually It actually equals the number of bones per number of organs. I don't know whether it's intended like that or not, but that's the way it is. Anyway, so there are 613 laws. And these 613 laws were then reduced to 11 principles in this 15. So if you go to Psalm 15, you can see David speaking of 11 principles. Who may dwell, Lord, who may dwell in your sacred dwelling, who may dwell in your holy mountain. Maybe know whose work is blameless, who does what is righteous, utters truth from the heart. And so we have 11 principles like that. Then it was further reduced to 6 principles in Isaiah chapter 33. So those 6 principles are the same thing. God is saying, who can dwell with the consuming fire? Who can dwell with the everlasting burning? Who can? So he gives 6 principles. Who walks righteously, speak what is right, reject gain from extortion. There are 6 principles. So 613, the 11 in Psalm 15, 6 in Isaiah 33, and this was then reduced to 3 in Micah 6:8. That is, what is Micah 6:8? What does the Lord require of you? To act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. So, and that is what Jesus is carrying. So act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. And so what was happening there? Why was God so angry with them? So many of God's people at that time, they thought that by making a lot of sacrifices and doing rituals, that they could draw more closer to God. And despite the many crimes that they did, they thought that by these things, they could draw more closer to God. They could make themselves pleasing to God. But no, what Micah was doing is he was attacking their fault thinking. He was saying that this does not make you closer to God. And so God spoke saying that, these are the three things I want. So actually, Micah was actually borrowing, or God was actually quoting from three of Micah's contemporaries, Amos, Hosea, and Isaiah. They were near contemporaries. So Amos was saying about justice, Hosea was saying about mercy, and Isaiah was saying about humility. So you can see the verses here. So it is from this that Micah 6:8 came about. And the politicians in Kerala actually say one thing. It means that I'm saying again and again and again. So when he wants to make a point, he speaks it again and again. So because I wanted to bring out this Micah 6:8 very clearly, as I am, that is why I'm saying it again and again and again. And uni parayana. So some of you may be in leadership posts, you may be having people working under you, or you may be taking interviews. So as a leader, what does God want to do with you? What is from this verse? So act justly would mean just behaving with justice and integrity in all your decisions. So suppose you are taking an interview. Would you take a person based on just his caste or beliefs, or would you take it based on his performance? Love mercy. Would you show mercy to the people around you? Somebody sins against you, would you show mercy? And how much are you going to walk humbly with God? Do you have a respectful relationship with God, and does that govern your strategy and lifestyle? That is what God is asking you if you are in a leadership post. And so being a good Christian actually requires more than just mere rituals. Now I have, there are people in our church actually who are not believers. They come from other religious background. But so for our Zoom meetings, actually they are the first ones to come. They will come at, we are meeting now at 10 o'clock. So they'll come at 10 o'clock. Everybody else will come, around, say, at 10:15 or something. But the reason is that they are used to, in their traditional churches, they are going to church at 5:30, 5 o'clock. They will participate in all rituals and all. So for them, actually, what is important is the rituals, the bhakti. But what God actually wants is, it's your heart. What is in your heart? That is what God keeps on saying. So what God wants to show the world is what is going inside of us. And that takes humility, action, a thing which Christ would exhibit. That is what God wants. And what was happening in Old Testament at that time, during Micah's time? So what was happening is that spiritual blindness actually led them to offer everything. But what God wanted, I'm keeping it saying it again, and what God wanted was a spiritual commitment from his people. And that is what was lacking. Now, I'll just say a small story. Now, there was a pig. A farmer had a pig and he loved his pig so much. And so what did he do? He said, okay, I don't want him to wallow about in dirt. So what he did was he cleaned the pig. He took the pig, he took it to the bathroom, washed it, and cleaned it all his dirt, and put some lipstick, put some mascara, and perfumed it, and tied a ribbon, and put a skirt around it. And now it is all beautiful. But once the farmer kept the pig back on the ground, what did the pig do? Straight away ran and jumped into the mud again. So all the effort was wasted. So what is the problem? The pig's heart had not changed. Maybe outside everything was changed, but the pig's heart had not changed. So what actually requires is what? The pig requires a heart transplant, or a brain has to change. So just a story. So what did the farmer do? Took out the heart, put in a new heart, and the heart of a man. So then it started becoming clean. So whenever a transplant occurs, things don't start changing suddenly. Takes time. It takes time for the organ to set in and start functioning and bringing out its characters. The same way, what God wants us from us is a heart transplant. He wants to change our hearts, not our external things. Our external rituals don't matter. What God wants from us is a heart transplant. It takes time for these things to work. We might say that, okay, I'm born again, baptized, but nothing's actually not changed. Nothing changed much. Take strength, it takes time, because if suddenly all this righteousness hits you, you will not be able to take it. So just keep on plodding on. So what does the Lord require of you? Act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. Now I am taking a sidetrack. So this is the right sidetrack. Now, when Micah was saying walk humbly with your God, I'm sure what would have come to the mind of the people listening to is the person, it would have reminded them of a person with humility. The person with the maximum humility whom God testified is, you know what, that is Moses. So what did God say about Moses? Moses is a very humble man, more humble than anyone else on the face of the earth. That is what is said in Numbers 12:3. So it is Moses that would I come to the mind of the people listening to it. Now let me just go with some points regarding Moses. And I would take some liberty to fill in gaps in Moses' history from some extra-biblical Jewish literature. So most of it is from the Bible. So we know that Moses' mother's name was Jochebed, and father's name was Amram. So we know that Moses born at the time of great tribulation, where Pharaoh had ordered that all the male children should be killed. Now, it is said in Numbers 26:59 that probably Jochebed would have been born at the time when Joseph was the prime minister. So she has seen good times, and now suddenly things have changed. And so now she has this beautiful boy. And from the time of birth itself, they knew, this father and mother knew that this child is special. This child is special. So that's why they hid this child. And they prayed to God. So how did God act? God is faithful. God brought about the Pharaoh's daughter except to take care of Moses. And so we know the story. Moses is brought up by his parents for the first three months and even paid to do it. And Moses grows up as a prince of Egypt. Moses was a prince of Egypt with all the luxury, all the education, all the armed training, and all. So that is how actually Moses grows up. And it is said that the Egyptians knew that there was going to be a deliverer, and they were doubtful whether this chap is going to be the deliverer. But then, after being for 40 years, it is said in Acts 7. So in Acts 7, it is a speech of Stephen. And in that, actually, we can get a lot of insight about what is happening in Moses' life during the time. The Acts 7:23 says that God brought into remembrance Moses' purpose. Moses, so Moses knows at the age of 40 that who he is going to be. So, but what happens is Moses takes things into his hands and he goes and murders a Egyptian. So he has to run off there. Because of rash action, he has to run off. So where does Moses end up? He goes to Midian, and he goes near a well. And don't think Moses was a weakling. So do you know what happened near that well? There was a band of shepherds there who are trying to prevent the daughter of Jethro daughter of Jethro from taking water. So Moses single-handedly defeat all those bands of shepherds. So it might have to do with military training. It might have to do with the fact that he might have been having an arms. And Moses actually handsome person at that time. That's what we understand from the Bible. So now Moses becomes the son-in-law of Jethro, and now he settles down to a life in the desert. What does he become? A shepherd. Now, the key point about being a shepherd is shepherds are people who are despised by the Egyptians. You know, from Joseph's life, when Joseph's parents came, they sent the parents away to a place where outside Egypt. Why? Because they despise shepherds. So now Moses is now looking after the shepherds. And while he should have been speaking to Egyptian soldiers, now he's speaking to all fragile sheep. And why should be leading mighty armies, he leading sheep. Like, how is life has changed? And Moses is actually a great orator, because that is what Stephen says. He's mighty in speech and action. That is what Stephen was saying. So now Moses settles down in the life in the desert. 40 years. 40 years of heat and dust and sun. This is from the comfort of Egypt to this. And all his illusions of grandeur are now come down. Like, he thought he was going to be the liberator, but everything has now changed. And I would imagine that then Moses would be looking to the sky and thinking, "What God, where are you now?" Like, and when he would be seeing the caravans going to Egypt, and he would thinking, "God, where are you now?" And it is said in the Bible that Moses accepted his now lot as a shepherd, and he settled down. And maybe he had already had two children, and he'd be thinking, "Okay, maybe I'll have grandchildren. Maybe get all the sheep from my father-in-law." So that is what Moses thought. But then God had other plans. Okay. Then God suddenly appears in the burning bush. But by now, this time, Moses completely changed. Moses probably having now coronary artery plagues, and maybe some plagues in the brain, and scars and wrinkles and corns in his feet. It's completely different. Not the handsome person. But now that is exactly where God wanted to meet. And that is how God always works. God's power is made perfect in our weakness. I always think, if God was to run a factory, you know what factory God will run? God will run a brick baking factory. factory. Why? How do you make bricks? You need clay, you need some water, then you put it in the furnace with intense heat, and then it comes out a beautiful brick, beautiful firm brick. For that, you need clay. If you are a very strong stone, you're already a brick. What can God with you? No, God cannot use you. You need to be broken into dust, and you need to be watered, and you kept in a furnace. That is how you're going to come out. Then only can God use you that. So that's the way God keeps on using people. So now Moses was now broken. And so broken that when God is telling him, go to Egypt, he said, "No, please don't send me." Four times he said, "Please don't send me, please don't send me." So much so that God got angry. And then God tells him, "Okay, I'll send Aaron. You go." And so, and remember that this time, Moses doesn't even know whether Aaron is alive. And there are 2 million Jews. 2 million Jews that he has read out. But he just believes God, and he sets out. And so starts one of the greatest comebacks in history. A single man on a donkey with just a stick in his hand goes out to meet the most powerful emperor of that time, goes out to meet the most powerful king of that time on a donkey with a staff, disbelieving God. So what happened? What turned things around? God broke him, and he learned humility. So that's the key thing that happened. Moses learned humility. And all of this, Moses had a speech impediment also. Moses saying, "God, I have a thick tongue. Don't set me." Yeah. And earlier, he was powerful in speech and action. Well, everything has changed. And then exactly at that time, God steps in and says, "Now is the time I want to be. Now we are broken. Now we are humble." So Moses might be thinking, it's like a tapestry. Have you seen it? Tapestry means like a big carpet which you hang on the wall. So if you look at the back side of the tapestry, you will not understand what is on the other side. So Moses is now on the back side of the tapestry, and for this last 80 years, he was thinking, "God, when I was prince in Egypt, then you could have sent me." If God had appeared to the burning bush when he was prince of Egypt, Moses would have said, "Yes, send me. I will kill 100 Egyptians for you. Jared, yes, I know." But when everything has changed, then God suddenly shifts, turns over the tapestry, and then Moses sees that beautiful design that is in front. God turned the tapestry at the right time, and that started the greatest comeback in Old Testament history. So, yeah, this is how the tapestry looks. So, our life is many times a lifelong lesson in humility. Some of us would have known that, and I also learned that. Like, it's not that 10 years back when I finished my sociology degree and everything, I thought I knew everything. But over a period of time, life has been a lifelong lesson in humility. You said that when you're older, you will realize that life is a lesson. And it is only by God's grace can we overcome. It's only by God's grace can we get that humility. So, how do we know about grace? Where do you get grace from? Above, like, you have to look up. Only then you will get grace. Like, what is grace? Grace is Christ, God's riches at Christ's expense. So, what happens is that a proud man is always looking down. Looking down on things, looking down on people. But as long as you are looking down on people, you won't understand God's grace which is coming from above. So, look above to God to get grace. And then only can you learn humility. And we see in two places in the Bible which is saying that clothe yourself with humility. Clothe yourself. Why is it said in two places? Because obviously it is important. That is why probably it is said in two places. Colossians 3:12 and we know 1 Peter 5:5. Clothe yourself with humility. What does that mean? And then in artham, clothe yourself actually in that term actually means it means like putting an apron around. Actually, it is used for slaves putting an apron around so that the clothes don't get unclean. So, clothe yourselves with humility. That is so important. And what actually allowed this saying from Saint Augustine? It is pride that changed angels into devils, and it is humility that makes men as angels. Like, what brought on devil? It is pride. Like, and what does the devil even do even now? We know that famous verse, "Gallard, be sober, your enemy." The devil prowls around like a roaring lion. Devil is not the roaring lion. The roaring lion is the lion of Judah. He's our Jesus. Devil is an imposter. He's going around like a lion, like a prowling lion. So what is he going to do? He's going to trap us. How do we escape his trap? Now, you know, in our country, in India, actually, there's a lot of talk going about the fighter jets and this country and this kind of jet. Now, this is one of the most feared, the picture I put in this, this is one of the most feared jets in the world. It's a B-2 stealth bomber. What makes more so fearful is that it is a stealth nature. It cannot be seen. Nothing can be done against it. So our stealth weapon, do you know what is our stealth weapon? Our stealth weapon is humility. Our stealth weapon against the devil is humility. So nothing sets a Christian so much out of the devil's reach than humility. Because devil does not know humility. He cannot do anything out of humility because that is his problem. That is how the devil became a devil from being an angel. So learn humility. And some practical things. Pride actually concerned is what who is right, and humility is concerned with what is right. I'll just explain. When I do surgery, is actually the natural, if somebody does something wrong, the natural tendency is to scold someone like, why did you do like that? Why do you retract like that? Or somebody makes a junior machine mistake. Why do you say that? So actually our pride, that is actually pride from our part. A humble person, what he's supposed to do is he's supposed to concentrate on the task. Like, if they were not able to repair, simply retract properly. Or you did not do something, please do that properly. Rather than the person, concentrate on the task. So humility is concerned with what is right, while pride is with who is right. And actually, it's a counterculture to us. In our culture, humility is actually counterculture. Nobody loves it. What do people do in a profession? We want to, when we do something, we immediately put it on Facebook. I did that. Bought a car. Did that. I bought a house. Did that. Or got a promotion. I put that on Facebook. Even a housewife also nowadays. I made a dish. That also put on the Facebook. But our natural tendency is to promote ourselves. But what Christianity wants is go counterculture, against your culture. And what is our culture? Our culture is humility. But why do people do all things to get promotion? Like, get promotion, workplace promotion, at home promotion, at wherever you are. So remember this key point: our promotion comes neither from the east, nor from the south, but it is from the Lord. Your promotion is from the Lord. So be strong, be courageous, be humble, be counterculture, because our promotion is from the Lord. And when you step according to the word, God will help you out. And two practical points regarding humility is that humility and gratitude are a perfect pair. They are like twins. If we, especially in my place, a lot of very rich people, somebody brings in a car. So I stop my, say, he stopped my car and let him pass through. There should be some humility to say thank you or something. But here, or in many places, what happens is they have a sense of entitlement. Oh, I am a very wonderful person. So actually, he's supposed to do that. So showing ingratitude actually is a sign of pride, actually. So showing gratitude. Think about in your lives. So be generous with your gratitude. Somebody does something, be generous with gratitude, because that is one outward manifestation, humility. And the second thing is patience. Humility, a lot of patience. Humility actually goes with patience. I've shown a lift and a step. Now in your country, actually, there will be a lot of lifts, super fast lifts. Here also in some buildings, there are super fast lifts. You get it in 1 second, actually, you'll reach the 20th floor. Doesn't take any time at all. But in a step, what you take a lot of time. You jog in and say all the steps, and by the time you reach top, you'll be very sweaty. Now, this is the point I want to make. In the kingdom of God, there are no lifts. There are only steps. In the kingdom of God, there are no lifts. There are no steps. What I mean is this: nothing happens suddenly in the kingdom of God. It takes time. It takes patience. You are going to climb step by step by step. And when you climb step, you are going to develop muscles. You're going to sweat. It's going to be hard work. But that's the way God wants it to be. And you look at things which are around. When you stay in step, you might find some gardens, see other buildings, and you develop spiritual muscles. So when you suddenly see somebody arising, there is usually some story behind it. You see Joseph being promoted to the prime minister in one day, but there's a long story behind it. There are no lifts in the kingdom of God, only steps. So humility actually has to do with patience. Humility has to do with gratitude. So, that is what is going to take you far in life. And so we learned about one prime example of humility, that is Moses. But finally, which is the greatest comeback of all? That is Jesus. I mean, Jesus is a perfect example of humility. Because and the best way to learn about Jesus, I was recently reading a book called very famous book, Grace for Christianity by Lee Strobel. And so the best way you can learn about Christ is by reading the Gospels. So keep on reading. Then I might find sound very familiar, but keep on reading, and then you will imbibe that what Jesus is doing. And Jesus is a perfect example of humility. So live the gospel. Yeah. And live and love like Jesus. So what did Jesus do? He humbled himself on the cross. He humbled himself on the cross. And so what happens? The resurrection, which is the greatest comeback of all time, happened. So we have one comeback of Moses, one of the greatest comeback in Old Testament by humility. And we have the greatest comeback of all history by Jesus humbling himself on the cross. So you might think this year of 2020 is a year of setback. You might think it's a year of setback. But have faith. Humble yourself. Humble yourself in the Lord's mighty hand. Humble yourself in the mighty hand. And He will lift you up. So this year is not yet over. There are 5 more months to come. So humble yourself. And the Lord will turn your setbacks into comebacks. And the comeback is always greater than the setback. God bless you all. Thank you.